Okay, let us start our afternoon session. And the first speaker is Professor Luca Amendola. His affiliation and the title of the talk is much better to see at the screen. Okay, please start. You have 30 minutes minus several minutes for questions.
Okay, very good. So thanks a lot. Thanks, everybody. Thanks for the invitation. It's really a pleasure. So the title is actually slightly different from the one I submitted some time ago, but it's the same, except I decided that maybe it's better not to give a review, but actually to focus on a few aspects, which I think might be either more interesting, well, certainly a bit more interesting for me, but also perhaps more like, more closer to the topics of this session. All right, so let's start. So this is a work in collaboration with Christoph Betterich, Javier Rubio, and Stefano Savastano. And I begin with this, just a second, of course there is, yes. This slide here, which shows the usual image that you've seen so many times. And we normally like to talk of a dark age, you know, from recombination up to today or up to some recent epoch. And we say it's a dark age because we have not much information, not directly, at least not so far. So actually it's not dark at all, it's just dark because we can really still have very good direct information. It's difficult to receive light from things, redshift larger than a few. But actually there is another epoch of the universe, which is this one here, before recombination, which is really dark. I like to call it really dark age, because we cannot receive light from there. We could in principle receive perhaps gravitational waves in the future, but certainly not light because the universe was not transparent. So it seems that we have very few direct information from this really dark age. And my talk is a bit about that. What else can we know about this? Can we think about new physics and something observable coming directly from this really dark age, from before recombination? There are, of course, already some, of course, already have some direct or almost direct probes. Well, not really direct, but almost direct probes. For instance, Big Bang nucleosynthesis. We know that the amount of light nuclei should be such and such to be consistent with observation. And nucleosynthesis occurred, of course, in the really dark age before recombination. We also know that the CMB blackbody spectrum, it's black body because it didn't get energy injection, significant energy injection before recombination. So the very fact that it's a black body spectrum to very high precision telling us something about physics before recombination. Also, we can study B modes on CMB. They should be produced also by gravitational waves before recombination out from inflation, also non-Gaussian. So there are a few things that we can say about what happened before. But this is really it's probably not enough. So I want to study another possibility, the one of early structure formation during the really dark age. And you will see in a second what I mean with this. Of course, to talk about structure formation, we need to talk a moment about dark matter. What is dark matter? Well, we always say, oh, it's a floating free particle out there in the halo of galaxies. Well, not really. It actually clumps by gravitational collapse. So different cosmological history, different universe will have different structure, different substructures. For instance, in this image here, you have a standard cold dark matter model, while on the right, you have a warm dark matter model. And you see the structure is significantly different. This is just dark matter, no other things there. So the substructure is stronger in CDM and is a bit weaker in warm dark matter because dark matter have a velocity which is higher, it's warm, and therefore it's smoothed out a bit more. So the picture we have of dark matter is actually not that it's just a floating free particle in the halo, but it's actually collected in many substructures. And according to embodied simulations, people think that roughly 10% or so dark matter is collected into this little cluster, this substructure, 10 to 15% of dark matter. So there is a smooth component in the halo and a clumpy component in this substructure. What do we say also about bound objects, dark matter, or any kind of bound objects? Well, the standard law is that bound objects form a very small redshift. They've been linear in the past and become non-linear kind of recently. And that's based on various assumptions. Is it based on the assumption that gravity is the only unscreened long-range force? On the assumption that primordial density fluctuation is a scale invariant? understand that matter fluctuations do not grow in the early universe, in particular during the radiation era. We will see some of this. So for instance, the question of primordial density fluctuation, if we take the inflationary standard initial power spectrum and we extrapolate to very small scales, well, we have a very small spectrum and it's not enough to create, generally speaking, it's not enough to create a strong structure except today, except after a billion of years of growth. That's not entirely true. Actually, we had the talk early in this session about primordial black holes. It's a very hot topic nowadays. And well, primordial black holes is an example. It's not the one I want to talk about, but it's related somehow. Primordial black holes is an example of structure formation right after inflation. How does it work? I'm sure you know already, but let me just spend a few words on this in order to compare and contrast with my scenario. Primordial black holes are normally assumed to form when there are some peaks, spectral peaks, due to features in this low rolling potential. For instance, this rolling potential here, you can have an inflection point. Inflection point means that the derivative is small or zero. This enhanced formation, this epsilon is small, this enhanced power spectrum. And on the power spectrum of the inflation, you have a kind of bump or a kink or something. And when you have this, then you can have you can have generally an extra formation of structure. And this structure is typically thought to immediately collapse, since it's nonlinear, into black holes, primordial, created during the first seconds of the universe. And today, to form a peak of sun mass. Typically, the structure, these features here, of course, at a very particular point. So as a result, you get typically a peak focused or centered around a particular mass scale. So the breadth of this peak is relatively small. By the way, this plot here is density of matter in primordial black holes divided density in dark matter. And you would like this to be unity or as large as possible if you want to argue that primordial black holes do constitute, do form most of the dark matter around the universe. Now, this scenario is very interesting, has been very popular, especially, of course, in connection with gravitational waves created by black holes of around the solar mass, up to 100 solar masses or so, but also has some problems. You want to have a special potential, you want to have a special feature at some point, and in that case, you create objects which are very compact, and black holes, there's nothing more compact than a black hole. It's actually interesting that we just got the Nobel Prize about black holes just today, but that's not an actual book. It just happened to be, you know, right on the news. And congratulations, of course, to the Nobel Prize winner. All right, so the problem is that there is many constraints because black holes are very compact, exactly. So they disturb white binaries, they disturb the CMB, this energy injection due to the presence of these black holes. If they're too small, they evaporate. They can be seen in microlensing experiments. There are many, many constraints. And of course, it's very controversial. People say that it's already practically ruled out. Other people say, well, you don't have to have a specific mass. You can have a range of masses. And so perhaps you can have several bumps somewhere here, and the sum of all the bumps maybe go to unity. Anyway, I don't want to say that this is ruled out definitely. I don't think so. But there are problems with this scenario. So I want to study something alternative, but with some connections, you will see. All right, well, say again, when do bound objects form, cluster? Well, as I say, this result is based on gravity, and this only on screen force, and the matter fluctuation should not grow. And I want to challenge both statements, both assumptions. Well, let's have a quick review of what happens in the normal scenario. Let's define a density contrast. If you write down the sub-horizon matter growth equation, they look like something like this. They're slightly non-standard just because I like to use, instead of time, logarithm or scale factor, you know, the folding time, but they're essentially the standard equation you find in every textbook in case you have only matter and radiation. So what happens during radiation epoch? So we are back in the past, radiation epoch, before the coupling. Redshift of 10,000, something like this. Perturbation do not grow because during radiation, matter is negligible. That's why we call it radiation epoch. And delta radiation is also very small because that's sub-horizon equations and radiation do not form sub-horizon structures, not strong ones. So delta radiation is very small. It's a very hot fluid. So what happens in this equation immediately, that delta matter is essentially constant, do not grow during the radiation epoch. All right, so let's introduce my scenario. It's relatively simple. You have two fields, a matter one. Let's think of psi as a dark matter field. That's what the role will be at the end. I don't specify what that is. I just say, let's introduce this field. And the light field, phi, which you could think of it as dark energy, but again, it's not, I don't want to make necessarily this assumption. I just say, let's assume there are two fields, which could be scalar or fermions. I take psi to be a fermion, that's not crucial. And let's imagine there is an interaction between the two. So I'm modifying gravity, essentially. So you see the title which originally I gave, cosmology modified gravity, is actually correct. I modify gravity, it's exactly not gravity, if you want to insist, it's actually a new interaction, which looks a bit like gravity, although it's a scalar interaction. And what happens is that if you do this and you look down, look at the question, at the mass of this matter field, remember I call it psi, I use psi as a matter field. What happens is that the two fluids, phi and psi, will be coupled by a coupling beta, which is essentially depends on this, on the fact that the mass of the psi field depends on the other field. So because of this coupling here, there is a coupling in the equations of motion. That would be the ordinary conservation equation that you have in standard when there is no interaction. And this is what happens in this scenario. It's very simple. You just have an exchange of energy on the right-hand side. The total energy is conserved, but you have an exchange of energy which looks like this. And oh, everything depends on beta. It could depend also on the potential of phi, but we don't need to talk about that. It actually doesn't play any role. So we don't have to discuss whether phi is really dark energy. It could be, but it's not necessary for this scenario to work. So let's keep a bit in mind that there is this interaction. What happens then? Well, if you just evolve this equation, then it's very simple to study this equation. It's been done several times in the past, except typically most people, including myself, studied this in the late universe, and now I'm in the relatively early universe. So you have often, I like to plot this omega quantity density in the various species versus time. This is the relatively, is today, so this is the late universe, and this is the early universe. Now, late universe remains exactly the same in our scenario. You will see exactly why in a second. But the important thing happened in the early universe. Because of this exchange of energy and assuming beta to be constant and pretty large around unity, in this case, and beta's dimensionless quantity can take it to be the order unity. If this is order unity, larger than this in particular, then something happened in the early universe, that there are an epoch in which the two fluids, psi and phi, are constant. The omega, sorry, the density of this quantity there, the fractional density is constant, which means that these two fluids decay in time, just like radiation. They are sort of dark radiation, if you wish. The rest is just standard. There is radiation goes down, baryons, blue goes up and then down again, and then the kinetic and the potential energy of the dark energy field will take over. So this part is kind of standard. I don't need to discuss this at all, actually. Let me focus on this regime. Now, what happens in consequence of this? And notice that everything depends, again, just on beta. So everything in my scenario depends on, essentially on beta. Well, what happens is this is the standard equation of perturbation that I showed a moment ago. And now this becomes this new equation here with several changes. There's an extra friction term, an extra quantity here. You can see on the right. I hope this is not... it's not overlapping with the image, with the video, but anyway. There's this constant epsilon, which again depends on beta. And this quantity here, omega psi, which in the standard scenario is negligible, it's essentially omega matter, now it's not negligible, might be small, but it's not negligible, it's a constant. So this term here is actually doesn't play much of a role, so I don't need to discuss that. But these two terms here are actually important, because when beta is very large, then y times omega psi is actually a constant. So instead of being negligible as before, instead of being zero as before, now this term is positive and can have some value. So we take the effective gravitational force large, the amount of psi can be large, of course, much smaller than radiation, as you had here, much smaller than radiation. So I'm not disturbing much the radiation and the usual Big Bang nucleosynthesis and things. They remain pretty standard because it's relatively small. But it's much larger than what would have been in the standard scenario. So there is this quantity this dark matter quantity, which is a constant fractional density, constant omega. All right, now you solve this equation. It's a very simple linear equation. It becomes extremely simple. Beta even disappears because of taking the large beta limit. And you get that delta psi, instead of being constant, or almost constant, grows very fast. Grows with a scale factor to a number which is roughly 1.6, this number here. So in this scenario, there is structure for recent development, but it's not what I want to discuss now. All right, so let's just, I need to spend now 1 second on this number. This number here, I don't know if you noticed, it's a very nice number, it's 1.618. Maybe reminds you of something. What should remind you of the golden ratio? This actually is exactly the famous golden ratio that you find everywhere in nature. Of course, this is just a coincidence. I'm not claiming that there's any design here, but it's fun that we find the golden ratio even in cosmology. All right, so let's go back to standard physics. What happens now? Well, we should discuss how these things grow. In order to discuss how they grow, we should go nonlinear. So we have to modify the previous equation, including nonlinear terms, and now we get something like this. This cannot be solved analytically, at least we have been not able to do so, so we solve it numerically. And it happens what happens in all spherical collapse scenario. The perturbation grows, expands, reaches a turnaround, and then collapses. And you can evaluate the density, the threshold of collapse is delta C. And again, that will be a function of beta, and these details are actually not so important. You just have to imagine that this object, depending on the initial value, reach a maximum radius and then collapse. What is important, well, we have somehow to assume by hand, is that at some point there is a virialization. Virialization, you cannot find it in the, from this equation because this is supposed to be just valid, assuming and we are just solving the spherical collapse case. So we cannot have virialization if you assume sphericality down to the end. So we have to assume that at some point, like in all spherical collapse problems, the kinetic energy, the potential energy are roughly equal, and we call that virialization. If this virialization takes place, then you can easily evaluate that takes place at a particular value of the scale factor, which again depends on beta. Everything depends on beta. And then we need to assume a second thing. We need to assume that at that moment, there is screening. That means we assume what is assumed in all modified gravity scenario, that when objects become nonlinear, then the extra interaction, this extra gravity is actually screened and disappears from the view. This, of course, depends in detail if you want to make a detailed scenario on the potential of the fields. We didn't do a detailed scenario. We just say we assume what is typically assumed in all modified gravity scenario, which is that this extra interaction somehow disappears from view because it gets in a high density, high nonlinear object, and then you get the screening. So if you allow me this assumption that there is virialization and there is screening, which are again, same assumption that is are done in every nonlinear spherical collapse scenarios, but they're crucial in our case. Then we can go back to this plot and reconstruct a bit in a slightly different way. This again, the density versus time, radiation just decreases at like 8 to minus 4, as we know. Baryons decreases at 8 to minus 3. So there is a moment in which radiation disappears, baryon takes over. But now there's an extra ingredient, there's this psi field. And this psi field first goes like radiation, goes down, it's parallel to radiation, that's why omega is constant. But then becomes nonlinear, becomes screened, and then from that moment on, just go like dark matter, just like A2 minus 3, like pressureless fluid. So this fluid psi, this dark matter, first behaves as dark radiation, and then when it collapses and gets screened, behaves as ordinary pressureless matter. And the way it does, the moment in which this happens, depend on the value of beta. Everything depends on beta. Due to our numerical simulation, we are able to find a relation between the values of the constant and the mass that you form after this process. This also depends on the initial value of psi, and we typically take as the initial fluctuation, the standard inflationary power spectrum. We don't need to modify the inflationary spectrum. It's the standard one. So in this sense, it's very different from most black hole, primordial black hole scenario. And again, we find a radius of turnaround of virialization, which is of the order of 100 astronomical units, depending on the mass. So just to fix the idea, if you have a solar mass and you want to compress the solar mass in these objects, then you get three times the size of Neptune's orbit. We call these objects, I don't know if I mentioned that before, sorry, maybe I didn't mention, we call them primordial dark matter halos. is a kind of a mixture, is taking something from dark matter halos, ordinary dark matter halos, and primordial black holes. They're taking properties from both, but they're intrinsically different. And we are able to predict the mass, the relation between mass and radius. At the end of the day, they all depends on the coupling, which normally should be very large. And this number just, of course, depends on the mass, depends on many things, but we have in mind always a beta relatively large, of order of larger than unity. So it's a strong, very strongly modified gravity, but it's only visible in the past, not today. And you get object of a given radius depending on the mass. Let's have a look again at the constraints. Well, that's the same plot I showed a moment ago, strong constraints on primordial black holes. What happens in our case? Well, let's look, start with CMB constraints. As I mentioned a moment ago, they normally derive from the fact that if you have a black hole, a primordial black hole, then there is matter orbiting around and then fall into black hole, and this creates an energy disturbance, energy injection, due to the accretion in particular, into the CMB. If this happens before a combination, then CMB is distorted and you don't get a black body spectrum. In order to have this below observation, then you have strong limit on the existence and abundance of primordial black holes. But this crucially depends on the fact that accretion for a primordial black hole happens close to the Schwarzschild radius. But for our primordial matter halos, there's no Schwarzschild radius. I mean, the object is much, much larger, much fluffier. So the effect is negligible. We evaluated that in detail in our paper and we found this to be completely negligible. So all the right-hand side of these constraints essentially disappear in our case. How about microlensing? Microlensing is a bit more delicate. Because now you have to imagine this object, this primordial dark matter halos floating around in our galaxy. So forget about the usual picture of dark matter particles. Now dark matter is into these sub-halos, which could be one solar mass, 10 solar mass, floating around in the galaxy. By the way, I didn't mention that the mass should be also in our scenario pretty much confined into a particular value, but this is not, it's not a crucial requirement. So normally we assume all these objects to be either 1 or 10 or 100 solar mass. That's a free parameter, which actually depends on beta. So beta is our free parameter. All right, so suppose you have them in the galaxy, in the Milky Way, then you will have microlensing. Microlensing means that you have amplification of luminosity, of brightness as a function of time. Experiments on microlensing only last for a few years. So if an object is always magnified for more than a few years, that you don't see it. You only see it if the magnification changes, like in this plot here. So from this, we can get magnification mu according as a function of the mass of our primordial dark matter halos. And we find, perhaps a bit counterintuitively, that if the object is very massive, then there are no constraints. And this is what I mentioned a moment ago. If the object is very massive, it's also very large. And the time it takes for the microlensing to happen is longer than the time of the experiments. So we find that actually all objects, all primordial black holes with a mass larger than 10 to minus 1 are actually below the current detection from microlensing. So also the microlensing constraints are much weaker, as you could have expected, of course, than the primordial black holes. So there is an allowed parameter space. We consider various other constraints, but I'm trying to simplify a bit now. And the parameter space as a function of mass, as a function of radius, tells you that there is still lots of space. There is also nucleosynthesis constraints, which are kind of obvious. We don't want to have too much of these things in the early universe, otherwise they will disrupt and change the abundances. So there is still lots of space, in particular this region here between the lines, which is compatible with the standard extrapolation from the primordial inflationary power spectrum. Although the extrapolation at very small scales is very uncertain, if you don't do any trick, we just extrapolate, then we are in this region. If you're allowed to tilt a little bit, then of course we can expand, but we can definitely stay in this region, it's perfectly fine. We are running now, of course, that's a first approximation, all these constraints, so we are running now n-body simulation based on our scenario, but unfortunately I still don't have results from that. So I will still keep talking about this analytical, semi-analytical results. All right, so there is still some allowed parameter space in which you have dark matter object confined into primordial dark matter halos, passing all the MOS constraints and being around, floating around in our halo. So let's have a look. Yes, thanks a lot. Very good. So let's again compare our stuff with the other things. Primordial black halo have a high density, of course. ordinary dark matter subhalos a very small density, and our object are right in between. We are denser than primordial black halos, many orders of magnitude, but also many orders of magnitude more dense than ordinary dark matter halos. So our objects are intermediate between primordial black halos and dark matter halos. These are standard dark matter halos. So it's a new way to think of dark matter. It's neither into primordial black holes nor into ordinary substructure. It's somewhere in between, with objects which are denser than black holes, but much denser than usual n-body simulation substructure of dark matter. Can we distinguish in particular from dark matter halos? So now I forget about primordial black holes, only compared to dark matter halos. As I say, our objects are smaller, typically more compact. And the distribution is also expected to be quite different, although in order to be able to do better this job, we should run simulations, and we don't have yet results. But let's consider these two things, smaller and more compact. What effect you can expect on the galaxy? Well, when you talk to astronomers, when I have been talking to my colleagues, astronomers, they say, oh, you have these things, then you can have so many effects. You can have that they interfere with the white binaries, that they have too many things. But when I ask this to my colleagues doing n-body simulation, they tell him, can you run a simulation with an object which is very large and 100 solar mass or media solar mass? I say, oh, actually, we do that all the time. Because when you run n-body simulation, you don't put particles. You put little clusters of particles. No n-body simulation has the power to put particles in the simulation to high resolution. So they put objects, except they put very large objects, 10 to 5, 10 to 6 clumps of dark matter. So we would like to run a simulation with something in between one solar mass and 100 solar mass. But in order to do so, we need either a new technique or a very high resolution body simulation. But we use a different method now to see whether our model at least doesn't break completely the rules of the game. And it is considering the stellar streams, which are becoming very popular now for astronomers. What are stellar streams? They are remnants of globular clusters which have been disrupted in our galaxy, and they create very long and thin streams of stars that you can observe. And these streams of stars that you can observe very carefully now with Gaia, with other photometric, with other surveys, are extremely thin and stable streams of stars, which look almost unperturbed, except they have once here or there some gaps and some deviation, some disturbance. So they are relatively undisturbed, but they do show some.
2 minutes left.
Very good. They do show some little disturbance. So it's interesting to use them as, you know, as a net to capture dark matter particles or dark matter objects. Well, we didn't do that really in much detail because there's lots of controversy. Well, not so controversy, but let's say the data are very recent, so we don't know enough about stellar streams. But let's take some results of some recent papers on this GD1, which is the longest stellar stream of our galaxy, one of the most studied. If you put mass and size of alleged impactors, what kind of impactors you can have? Well, you can have molecular clouds, globular clusters, dwarf galaxies, and standard subhalos. These are the standard things that people consider so far. So if you consider the abundance, the mass and size of these objects as possible perturber, then you find various regions. But this is the region that should be that is necessary to explain the GD1 perturber. So it seems that we need more massive object, or if you prefer, more compact object than provided by standard astrophysics, including dark matter subhalos. If now I add to this plot our primordial dark matter halos, well, they extend to much smaller masses and sizes, but it seems that they would exactly be the kind of perturber you will need to explain these little gaps in the stellar stream. I say very clearly that this is extremely preliminary. We didn't even publish this. Thanks a lot, Andan. So this is very preliminary, but for me it's an interesting reason to look for objects which are more compact than ordinary dark matter halos. I'm actually done. I finish with this. There are still many open questions, merging, disruption, evaporation, but one maybe can be more interesting for us. Dark matter in our scenario remains mostly confined into primordial dark matter halos. Could be this the reason why no free dark matter particles have been detected? If they are there in this object, they do not float around, the smooth component is not there or is much smaller, maybe that's the reason. Okay, there are many other questions, including the fact that these primordial dark matter halos could become primordial black halos at some point. These are recent paper by Flores and Kuzenko. but I think I'll stop here. So thanks very much.
Okay, thank you very, very much. Fortunately, no questions. So let us thank our speaker again, and we will come. Thank you, Luca.
Thanks a lot.
And we will come to the next talk and next speaker, Maxim Khlopov.